I'm a 32-year-old individual living in a pleasant suburban neighborhood known for its respect of property boundaries and friendly atmosphere. We have an active housing association that efficiently handles complaints, so generally, there aren't many issues to contend with. However, my next-door neighbor, also named Christian, has consistently been a source of frustration for me. It seems he believes he can act without regard for how his actions affect others. One recurring problem is Christian's tendency to trespass onto my property as a shortcut, despite the fact that our houses are situated very close together. Instead of using the sidewalk like everyone else, he chooses to trample over my wife's flowers. Furthermore, he allows his aggressive dogs to roam freely, and although my children hesitate to blame the dogs, they've had multiple encounters with them that I suspect were not friendly. Because of our affection for animals, Christian usually keeps his dog chained outside. This presents an issue for me whenever I wish to relax in my yard with a beer, as I must contend with the barking and snapping dog. The presence of the frothing dog and the clinking of its chain do not make my property inviting. Christian has taken care to make the chain long enough for the dog to relieve itself right at the border of my lawn, adding to the problem. Furthermore, he fails to clean up after his dog, leading to numerous instances where my children have inadvertently tracked dog feces into our home, much to the dismay of my wife. I also have a plot of land behind my property that extends across my house, with many neighboring lawns adjacent to it. Although we live in a suburban area, there are several nearby fields, and I keep a horse in one of them. I purchased the horse as a gift for my daughter's 8th birthday, and she has taken excellent care of him, tending to his stable on the far side of the field, feeding him, and ensuring he stays warm in the winter. However, instead of a contented horse, we have a skittish, aggressive one that bites and kicks anyone who approaches it. The reason for this is the infrequent occasions when Christian releases his dog without supervision. The dog takes pleasure in chasing and nipping at the horse's heels, much to my daughter's frustration. On several occasions, the horse has kicked the dog in self-defense. Astonishingly, Christian has the audacity to demand that I cover the dog's vet bills. A head scan is also recommended in the event that the problem is brain-related. I've tried talking to him about it on several occasions, but he constantly dismisses me, saying that because we are neighbors, we should be more relaxed about these types of things. I mean, come on. I was friendly at first, and trust me, I tried to be diplomatic. I requested that he clean up his dog's mess to keep it from lunging at my children, as well as to oversee it and ensure that it did not wander into my field. Each time, he simply disregards me, referring to me as tight buttocks and advising me to unwind with a beer. Now I understand that we live in a friendly neighborhood. However, I believe that everyone should respect one another's boundaries, and Christian's activities have been bothering me for quite some time. More than that, they are driving me crazy. I've even put up a fence to attempt to keep him and the wicked dog out, but they always find a way through. The dog has burrowed beneath the fence and created a lovely little tunnel for himself. And Christian hops the fence carelessly. I've even received warnings from the housing association because the fence violates standards. They told me if I didn't take it down, I'd be fined. We only got away with it because my wife is close to the chairperson and I informed her about it. Describe the exact situation. I've even pondered putting up an electric fence around the field to offer the horse some peace of mind. But I'm scared that my daughter will accidentally touch it. She falls off the horse very frequently, but she's really skilled at picking herself up and going right back on it. But I'm afraid she'll be thrown off the electrical fence and injure herself. Not to mention the fact that Christian would expect me to cover the vet fees if the dog stubbed a toe. I don't want to cause any problems with Christian, but I'm at my wit's end. I believe he is taking advantage of our neighborly relationship and disregarding my boundaries. Not only that, but he is utterly stomping over them while also endangering my family. He knows what kind of deadly infections the dog is carrying in its mouth, which may be passed on to my children. I pondered calling the cops, but I don't want to aggravate the situation further. I don't want to waste their time by calling them out on something as petty as a neighborly issue. The housing association already has too much to deal with the property down the street and, well, the paint on the shutters is green, so they can't help right now. I don't know what to do at this point. I'm scared that if I don't take action, Butler will continue to stomp all over my property and ignore my lawful request. I'm scared that the dog may maul one of my children and severely injure them. I'm also concerned that the horse will see my daughter as a threat and kick her, injuring her skull or something. All of these possibilities are rushing through my head right now, and I'm actually afraid. At the same time, I don't want to alienate a neighbor or incite conflict in our otherwise tranquil neighborhood. But I believe it may be too late to preserve this thing, no matter what I do. Should I continue to try to communicate with Christian and resolve things quietly, or should I take more serious measures to safeguard my family? Any assistance would be highly appreciated, as I am completely at a loss. I'm grabbing at straws because my neighbor Christian's dog has been prowling my yard and biting my children. I was terrified that the dog would seriously injure one of my children, and then it occurred. I was in the kitchen conversing with my wife the other day when we heard our son scream. He's a theatrical kid who's recently had some issues with other kids in the area, so it wasn't surprising. However, this time the shouts were different. As a parent, she learned to recognize minor changes in the way your child screams or cries. And this one was simply different. It was a deep, painful scream. Obviously, my wife and I hurried out of the house as soon as we spotted our son down on the ground, while Christian's dog, still chained, attacked his arm repeatedly. I grew up with dogs. I know when a dog is simply being playful, and this one was not. He was shaking my son like a bunny. I don't think I've ever been more terrified than I was at that moment. I thought my son was going to die. I raced over and drop-kicked the dog as hard as I could to get it to let go of my son. It rushed away with its tail between its legs. We initially assumed that the blood was exaggerating the wound and that the bite was not serious. But as we wiped off the blood, we saw that my son definitely required stitches. So we transported him to the local hospital, where he received 8 stitches on his left arm. The injuries from dog bites were significantly more serious than we had anticipated. My kid broke his arm in 2 places as a result of the dog's shaking, and despite numerous attempts to have Christian accept responsibility, he refused to do anything. The injury was more than just a fun dog bite. The bite was deep. And my toddler needed several sutures. I mean, come on. It left a horrible scar. It was awful to witness my child in such distress. And then explain to the physicians why the neighbor's dog was permitted to injure them. He was in a sling for a month, and we ended up paying thousands in medical bills. Which, by the way, Christian declined to contribute to. I was outraged, of course. This gentleman requested that I pay for his dog's medical fees after our horse kicked it. But my son had been in the ER for 6 hours and didn't care one bit. He hasn't done anything with the dog. It continues to wreak havoc on my yard and attack me as soon as I exit the house. So I decided to take the next logical step and make a report with the police. I wasn't going to let this guy have his dog after what happened to my son. Oh God, I want to put that beast down. My children, who would normally be outraged at me for even suggesting something like this, I even came to the conclusion that, yes, this dog is hazardous, but it is also the best option. Every time kids try to leave the front or back door for school, they are terrified. My son is simply traumatized. He will not leave the house without his mother or me with him. But here's when it becomes even more frustrating. The police didn't take me seriously. They continued to insult, claiming that it was simply a dog bite. I shouldn't make a big issue about it. I tried to explain that my child needed 8 stitches and that Christian was at fault, but they simply rejected me and said they'd look into it. 3 weeks ago, I refiled the report. I have not heard a word. After visiting the police station, I was already upset and angry. I can't believe they discarded my report so quickly, and it felt like they were downplaying the seriousness of my child's injury. But then I discovered Christian's links to the police department. It was a punch in the belly. You're not going to believe this. It becomes mad. Christian's wife's brother serves as the chief of police. That's right, this guy is related to the town's leader. They're suppressing this case out of devotion. I feel like my head is about to explode. No one is listening to me, and all I need to do is find a method to safeguard my children before something terrible happens. You should have seen how the doctor handled my wife and myself when we came in with our son. You could tell they thought we were bad parents who couldn't even keep our kids safe from a dog. Well, I guess they're correct. It is our responsibility to safeguard these children, and we failed so miserably that our son sobs every time he walks out of our front door and by the animal. It appeared like the police were not taking my case seriously because they did not want to disturb Christian or his small circle. It was as if they were more concerned with maintaining their relationship with him than with carrying out their duties and serving justice. The more I think about it, the angrier I get. My child has been wounded as a result of this man's blatant ignorance and inability to accept responsibility, and it appears that no one is ready to hold him accountable. My concerns appear to have been ignored, leaving me feeling helpless and frustrated. I know I need to find a method to just seek justice for my child, but it appears like every path is closed. The cops do not take my report seriously at all. And now it appears that they are deliberately sheltering Christians from any consequences. It is an extremely irritating and discouraging scenario. I feel helpless. I'm frustrated with the police in this town. They should investigate the situation and hold Christian accountable for it. I mean, we're discussing a child's injuries here. I don't know where to go next. I only want justice for my child and for Christian to be held accountable for his acts. Honestly, I'm not proud of this. However, I've been considering alternative types of justice. As in, I've been considering taking this issue into my own hands. Now, believe me, I am not some kind of vigilante trying to solve the world's issues, but I am a father, and it is my responsibility to defend my family, and if the police do not interfere, I will have to be the one to do something about this mess once and for all. I mean, come on. I do not want to do anything illegal. That is not who I am, but at this point, I don't see any other options. So, I assume I'll wait for a few replies because guidance would be appreciated. When I first posted, many individuals suggested I contact the police. And watch how that goes. So, I'm looking for real comments here. This guy needs to leave my neighborhood, and the sooner the better. I just wanted to preface this update by stating that I understand that what I'm about to do may not be the best course of action. I know, but I feel like I've exhausted all other options. I cannot just let Christian get away with what he has done. And the police aren't taking me seriously. I don't want someone to use what I'm saying as a guide to copy. I know I'm not following the morally proper path here. I am just past the point of caring, you know. So, I came up with a plan. You see, Christians are superstitious. He's always been the type who believes in ghosts and the supernatural. We were really cordial when he first moved in next to me, before all of the troubles began. We used to sit in my yard and drink beers together before he brought in that dog. He told me about how his boyhood home was haunted, how he would hear ghosts while attempting to sleep, and how things would move by themselves. It was all bizarre. He mentioned cold areas, and his mother told him about the previous residents who had perished in the living room. Personally, I don't believe in anything like this. But I listened politely. I wasn't trying to be disrespectful, it just sounded like his mother was mentally ill, which damaged him as an adult. That's where I got my bright idea. I wanted to deceive him into believing that my house was haunted. I know it seems crazy, but please listen. I am going to pretend to forgive him for what happened to my child. And I'll invite him over for a drink or two. He is foolish. He'll never notice I'm faking it. I'm rather skilled at concealing my feelings. I can pretend I don't want to punch the man in the face. I'll make sure he has a few too many, and then I'll begin dropping indications that strange things have been going on in the house. This sounds ridiculous. I understand. Trust me, I know. I feel like a fool for coming up with this concept, and my wife thinks I've lost my mind. But I don't care. I understand that this may appear to be a severe move, but I feel compelled to take action in order to learn more about Christianity. Maybe in his intoxicated state, he'll reveal something about his relationship with the cops. Maybe I'll locate some evidence that won't aid me in my dispute with him. To be honest, I'm not sure what I am hoping for. I just feel like I need to do something. Even if it is as foolish as this, I am not going to sit here and allow him to continue putting my family at risk. I'm not proud of what I'm going to do. Christian deserves to be held accountable. And if that's all it takes, so be it. I only hope I don't regret this decision soon. As you all know, I was at my wit's end with the whole Christian problem. Despite my repeated attempts to hold him accountable for his dog's activities, he continued to refuse to accept responsibility. I was angry and frustrated because the authorities had not taken my report seriously, and I felt as if I had nowhere else to turn. I went ahead and completed it. I feigned to forgive Christian and invited him for one or two beers. We chatted about other topics, but I could tell he was still uncomfortable. I did not blame him. After all, he had harmed my child. He flinched whenever I moved. He was convinced I was going to hit him. I don't blame him for this, I truly wanted to. But I stayed friends and relaxed, and my wife and children were at my mother-in-law's place, leaving just us lads. As the night progressed, I began to draw suggestions of unusual occurrences happening in my home. I made up stories about hearing footsteps when no one was nearby and feeling like I was constantly being watched. I also took some of his childhood experiences and informed him that I was experiencing cold spots and that my wife had complained about them. Christian became noticeably uneasy and kept peeking over his shoulder. At this point, he was completely inebriated. So it was not difficult to give him additional ghost stories. He was shifting in his chair, so I decided to turn it up a notch. I began shifting things around the home when Christian was not looking. I even set up some simple pranks using fishing lines to make it appear as if objects were moving on their own. Christian was noticeably scared, as he believed my house was haunted. It was hardly the most progressive thing. I simply tugged on some ropes and caused some books to tumble off a shelf. I downloaded an app to control the TV and switch it on and off. It took everything in me not to laugh when he started freaking out, slurring his words, and shaking in his chair like a fool. My objective was not only to scare Christian. I wanted to gather some information from him, you see. So I kept asking him about his contacts in the police department and whether he would have any clout with them. As he drank more, Christian began to relax. He admitted that he did have contacts in the police department, that he had previously used them to get out of trouble, and that he would do so again. I appeared to be appreciative of his assistance and vowed to keep his little secret secure. What I discovered is this: Christian came to this community after his dog bit a child in his previous neighborhood. He had no pull there, therefore, the dog would be put down. To save the small hellhound, he purposefully relocated to a neighborhood under his brother's law's jurisdiction so that if it happened again, there would be no consequences. I eventually helped him back to his house, and his wife was unhappy that he had gotten so intoxicated. She apologized to me for having to carry him over, but what irritated me even more was that she was only ready to apologize for a messy drunken episode, not the lasting scar on my son's arm. I'm not sure what I'm going to do with this information, but I'll do something. As you may recall, I recently exploited his superstition against him, convincing him that my home was haunted. While he was utterly terrified, I was able to extract some useful information concerning his links to the police department. Initially, he was drunk off his buttocks. I intended to use that knowledge to pursue legal action against him and hold him accountable for what he had done to my child. However, after careful deliberation, I concluded that going to the police may not be the wisest course of action. First, as I previously stated, Christian has ties within the police department, correct? This means that any legal action I take against him may not yield the desired results. It's possible he can exploit that link to get himself out of trouble. Alternatively, reduce the punishment if he does receive something. I'm not sure who you're meant to go to when the cops fail, but whoever is a step above them is far beyond my pay grade. Despite my best efforts, I was unable to obtain the number. Second, even if I were successful in obtaining justice for my child, the court struggle would most certainly be long and arduous. The stress and time commitment necessary could have a negative impact on me and my family, and it may not be worthwhile in the end. I don't want Christian's friends to pressure my kids into acting like nothing happened in a police interview room. I won't put my family through that. I know I stated I was done with the legal path, but I was hoping that Christian would divulge some magical answer while inebriated that would force the cops to listen. But that is not what happened. And I have to accept this. So I accept that he has opted to adopt a different strategy. I'm going to continue to exploit Christian's superstition against him, making him as uncomfortable as possible in his own home. It's not the exact revenge I sought, but it's a little step toward making him feel the same anxiety and discomfort that my family has felt since his dog mauled my child. Maybe. He'll become so terrified that he flees the neighborhood with his tail tucked between his legs or something. I have been doing a lot of research online. Obviously, there isn't much information online regarding how to deceive your neighbor into believing their house is haunted, but I did find a few possibilities. See, those bogus ghost hunting shows were rather useful. Sometimes the team forgets to stand out of the camera's view, allowing me to see what they're using to make the place look so eerie. I've been brainstorming pranks and scares that I could pull off at Christian's house. I intend to do it when he is not present, so he will not realize it is me. Obviously, I don't want to get arrested for harassment or something. I'm hoping that he will experience this as if a vengeful ghost or other entity is following him from house to house. And it will make him so uncomfortable that, ideally, he will want to leave the neighborhood on his own. I realize this isn't the most adult, responsible attitude, but I'm at my wit's end with this scenario. I just want Christian to experience the same worry and concern that we have, and perhaps this will help him understand the enormity of what he has done. I don't even know if it will work. My wife calls me mad yet again, but the first time it worked. I'll keep you all updated on how things progress. Thank you for your help and advice so far. If anyone has expertise with this type of stuff, which I doubt, but if you do, please let me know how it goes. So, it has been several months. But I simply wanted to update you on my ongoing feud with Christian. First and foremost, I need to inform you all that he is moving out. He is actually leaving, taking that terrible demon hound with him. I'm overjoyed. I can't believe I won, so how did I do it? As you may recall, I devised a scheme to exploit Christian's superstition by convincing him that his own home was haunted. My initial attempts to scare him during his visit to my house were successful, but I intended to take it a step further and drive him nuts. Convince him that the ghost has relocated to his own house. So, over the next 2 weeks, I started performing pranks on Christian. That would lead him to believe that his house was haunted one night. I went to his house and scratched his bedroom window, made some strange noises with my phone, and woke him up in the middle of the night. Christian was alarmed because it appeared that claws were to blame for the scratch marks. I used his own rake to accomplish it, which made me even happier. I'm a handyman, and while appearing to be friendly with Christian, I volunteered to fix up some things in his house. He's not one to pass up free work, so he agreed, and when he wasn't home, I set up some noise machines to generate eerie sounds like creaking floorboards and howling wind. I strategically placed those noises throughout the house, creating the illusion of movement. Christian couldn't decipher their source, growing increasingly convinced that something dwelled within the walls. To escalate matters, I threw stones at his windows in the dead of night, leading him to believe that an intruder was attempting to break in. In hindsight, I concede that this particular prank might have crossed a line, but I hold no remorse. Each of these schemes was meticulously devised to sow doubt in Christian's mind, to make him suspect a malevolent spirit haunted him. And it worked. It really did. Christian approached me, terror-stricken, seeking assistance. He firmly believed he inhabited a cursed abode, teetering on the brink of peril. Initially, I tried to offer sympathy and support, but my nature pushed me further. I confided in him, claiming to have encountered similar experiences in my own home and professing to possess a method for banishing the spirits. I convinced him that I had conducted a ritual to expel the ghosts from my residence and hinted that it might work for his house too. Thus, when he beseeched me for help, I instructed him to perform the same ritual, providing a list of peculiar ingredients he needed to gather. Of course, all the ingredients were fictitious, and the ceremony was a concoction of my imagination. Christian, desperate to rid himself of the apparition, believed my every word. He spent hours scouring the city for non-existent substances, and when he couldn't locate them all, he returned to me, pleading for further guidance. So, I simply fed him more falsehoods, insisting that the spirit was growing stronger and that he had to act swiftly. Christian's sanity was slipping away, and I reveled in my triumph. It worked flawlessly. He's relocating. Over the past few months, he's appeared increasingly haggard, shedding weight, and showing signs of sleep deprivation. I suppose everything has finally caught up with him. Yesterday, he informed me of his intention to sell the house, gather his family, and depart. You know what's even more amusing? He asked if I wanted to buy the house from him. I'm no fool, I understand he merely wanted to escape swiftly, hoping the imaginary specter would latch onto me. Nevertheless, it presented a remarkable opportunity, so naturally, I seized it. I secured the deal of a lifetime, purchasing the house for less than half its actual value. My plan is to create a connection between the two residences. My son remains scarred by the experience, and truthfully, I believe this quest for revenge has unveiled a side of me that my wife disapproves of. But I couldn't care less. I've savored the taste of victory.